We all know it. Walked it every day. But none of them were like these. The world's most dangerous ways to school. Freezing. Climbing. Risking their lives, all for the chance of a better future. Spectacular and sometimes simply beautiful. The world's most dangerous ways to school. The Bajo Cauca region in northern Colombia. Its landscape is marked by water and seemingly endless expanses. Every day, the children who live there face this rough, unpredictable wilderness with just one goal in mind: making it to school. Because this is their chance to break out of poverty and create a better life. For this, they subject themselves to a daily dose of danger. Some of them must cross a ramshackle bridge that could collapse at any moment. Others are confronted with waters and bogs. Each day they carry not only a backpack, but also the fear of coming face to face with a dangerous animal. For the D'Ojos family, the day starts at 4:30 in the morning. While daughter Kendys is still sleeping, father Salvador and mother Yasiris prepare breakfast. Like most people in this region, they live with very meager means. In this small wooden hut, they have just enough money for food. All the more reason why the 28-year-old mother wants to give her children the chance to have a better life. With the sunrise at 6 o'clock, Yasiris wakes her daughter, Kendys. Like almost every morning, the 10-year-old doesn't have much time. Lessons will begin in just 2 hours. Kendys school is far away, and getting there is a major undertaking. There is no running water. The people who live here use collected rain and river water for cooking, laundry, and washing themselves. Kendy's 11-year-old sister goes to the high school in the next bigger village of Kuturu, 20 kilometers away. The parents taught their two daughters what school is at an early age.
I like to go to school. I learn a lot there.
Her teacher promotes the talents of the individual students. For Kendys, it's painting.
This is from a movie we watched. The man had to collect the stones, and when someone touches the stones, they turn to gold.
About 50 families live in the community of La Variedad La Escuela. To get from A to B, the residents mainly use motorcycles or boats. Or they have to walk, like Kendys and the other school children.
The roads are very bad. It's super slippery. When it rains hard, we don't even go to school.
The distance and the path across a dangerous bridge are enough of a challenge for the children, in addition to the heat and high humidity, which make walking difficult. Just past 6:30 in the morning, Kendy sets off. Her mother joins her on the first leg of the journey to school. Temperatures are already around 32 degrees Celsius. But this is the least of Kendy's problems. What she's thinking about now is the bridge she has to cross. Living just a half hour away from her by boat, the school day starts differently for Kendy's classmate. 10-year-old Juan Carlos lives on his grandparents' farm.
I like horseback riding best. But I also like to drive the cows in. Those ones over there. I know all of them by name. When I call them, they come.
Like almost every morning, Juan has to bring the cows in from the pasture. It is not uncommon here for children to grow up with relatives. Juan's mother doesn't make enough money to raise two kids, so she decided to keep her younger son with her and send Juan to his grandparents. While Juan drives the last cows in, his grandfather, Jorge, begins with the milking. As a result of selling milk and cheese, he is among the better earners in the region. From his perspective, the fact that his grandson has to help does have its advantages.
He's learning how to care for the cows. For example, how to give them medication and help with birthing.
After half an hour, Juan returns with the cows. He still has 1.5 hours before class starts, exactly the time he needs to get to school. He's usually the last to arrive.
Sometimes I have to let the ducks out and feed the chicks. Then I shower and go.
Even if Juan is late and has to hurry, breakfast is important. The physical work makes Juan hungry, and there's still a tough road ahead. To make sure he has enough strength, he eats rice, eggs, cheese, and avena. An oat drink. Juan doesn't have to cross the rickety bridge like Kendys does, but he faces his own challenges.
I have to go on a canoe, and it can tip over very easily. And then there's a spot where I'm up to my chest in the water.
That's why Juan puts his school uniform in his backpack and changes into it later. Grandmother Ana Maria always finds it difficult to see her grandson off.
time. Chao. Mírame, chao. Me da mucha tristeza.
I'm very sad when I see him go away.
Hacia allá.
And rightly so. There are many dangers lurking along the 1.5 hour walk to school. River currents, swamps, poisonous animals, and the rising heat. Kendys and her mother Yasiris are only a few meters away from the bridge. Class starts in just an hour. After strong rains, they have to leave even earlier in the morning, because then the road is especially slippery and muddy.
The bridge is the most dangerous part of the way to school. Anything could happen at any time, both on the way there and back. It's the hardest part.
Without the bridge, it would take Kendys yet another hour to get to school. The children are never allowed to cross the decaying wooden construction alone. If anything should happen, someone else needs to be able to get help. This is why the 10-year-old meets her classmates, Andrea, Nivea, and Neidi at the bridge. Yes, this bridge. 180 meters long, 4 meters high. The footbridge is made of thin, rotting tree trunks that are only loosely connected. One false step, and they're certain to fall into the smelly water. The children could seriously injure themselves, or even drown.
I'm afraid I'm going to fall down and break my foot or my hand. It's always dangerous to cross the bridge.
From the very first step, the children have to keep their concentration. With every day and each downpour, the bridge becomes more unstable.
I'm afraid the children might fall, and if the wood breaks, they could drown or break their legs. I'm tortured with worry the whole day.
The nearest hospital is 2 hours away, and treatment would be expensive. The children have only one thought, to cross the wooden bridge safely. The wooden bridge their parents built for them to shorten their way to school. Kendys' father, Salvador, helped to build the bridge. Like 90% of the villagers, he has no permanent work. He does odd jobs like working in the fields or fishing, with which he earns the equivalent of just 280 euros a month. 2 years ago, it wasn't possible to move so freely. The guerrilla movement FARC had the area firmly in its grip. It fought against the government and its supporters. The population still suffers from the consequences, but is trying to get their lives back.
To really make a living, I'd need at least 10 fish like this a day. That doesn't happen very often. Fishing alone is not enough to pay for my daughter's education. It's just enough to feed us every day.
Although the state schools are free of charge, the families still have to pay for books, school uniforms, and travel expenses. Salvador wants his daughters to have a better life. That's why he and his wife put every cent into their children and into their dreams. Juan has to hurry. He left the house way too late today.
Now I have to cross the river in a canoe. I'm always afraid it'll tip over.
The canoe is extremely wobbly. One wrong move, and Juan would be sitting in the water, together with his school uniform and books. Juan learned to canoe 2 years ago from a man working for his grandfather. Besides the horses, the canoe is Juan's grandparents' only means of transportation. If they need a dugout canoe during the day, the boy has to swim home in the afternoon with his school supplies in his backpack, which is why a lot of his things have broken. Juan will have to walk for half an hour. As close as it is to the equator, the climate is almost constant throughout the year, hot and muggy. Due to the high humidity, it often rains at night. The ground becomes very soft, which means Juan has to work that much harder.
Now I have to put my backpack on my head. Sometimes the water goes all the way up to here.
The mud causes a lot of trouble for him. Juan can't see where he's stepping in the murky water. It's only 50 meters to the shore. But those 50 meters are what he's most afraid of. Meanwhile, Kendys and her friends continue to confront their own fears. They still have a good 70 meters ahead of them. 70 meters along which anything could happen at any time.
Friends of mine have already fallen down and hurt themselves.
Especially in the places where there's no railing, Kendy's heart pumps that much faster. It's even more unstable here. One basic rule is never step on the same trunk as someone else. If a trunk breaks and one child falls in the water, at least the other will be able to go for help. While the children are still fighting to get over the bridge, their teacher arrives at school. Yuri's journey with a motorcycle taxi begins Mondays at midnight Over the weekend, she always travels to her hometown of Medellín, 7 hours away. About 2 years ago, the government rebuilt the school. During the week, it's Yuri's home. It's a small chamber with no windows and no daylight, but Yuri tries to make the best of it.
It's my calling to be a teacher. If you don't feel called, you can't deal with it. There are tons of mosquitoes in my room. In the beginning, there was nothing. I had to bring everything from Medellín. It was really hard for me. There was no TV, no mattress, no blanket. It's difficult every time.
Two years ago, Yuri got one of the few permanent jobs available for teachers. It was a big shock when she learned where she was placed. Now, she has made it her goal to spread knowledge in remote places like this.
It's a big challenge. I'm afraid for my students. I don't feel calm because there's always something that could happen. They could drown or hurt themselves. The bridge is really difficult for the children.
Yuri now has a good half an hour of worrying until the first children begin to arrive. Kendys and her friends will soon have made it, if all goes well. The closer they get to the shore, the faster they go, and even forget the most important rule to keep their distance from each other. They can't get over the bridge fast enough. Ten-year-old Niidi has an especially difficult struggle. She suffers from a fear of heights. With every step, the feeling of dizziness rises, forcing her to her knees. Naidi's friends cannot wait for her together at one place. The danger of collapse is too great. After about half an hour, the first ones finally make it. They have solid ground under their feet once again. The children's exhaustion and relief is noticeable. It's not just the intense concentration, but also the heat and humidity that are tiring. 30 minutes in the blazing sun over a wobbly wooden bridge. It's become a part of everyday life, but it is something they will never get used to.
I'm relieved because nothing happened and nobody got hurt.
Class starts in just a half hour. There is still a long walk ahead, but the most difficult part is now behind them. For Juan, the most dangerous part is yet to come.
I'm afraid of the stingrays. If they sting you, you can die.
I have to be careful. They bury themselves in the mud.
A stingray's sting can be fatal or cause serious injury, but this is the only way to get to school. Mission accomplished. Without meeting a stingray, without getting the backpack and school supplies wet.
I am relieved because I have the mud and the water behind me now.
Finally, Juan can put on his dry school uniform. Class starts in 20 minutes. Although he already knows he's going to be late again, he's glad that he can go to school at all. It brings him a little closer to his dream of moving to a big city. Kendys, Nevea, Andrea, and Naidi have been on the road for over an hour now. Unlike Juan, at least they're not alone, which makes time go by faster. The temperature is already 34 degrees Celsius. At 7:45 in the morning, with humidity at 97%.
It's really super hot while walking.
We have to protect ourselves from the sun.
If we get too hot.
And when we go home in the afternoon, it's even hotter.
Even while they are walking to school, they are already thinking about the way back. Even hotter, and over the wooden bridge again. If the children are lucky, an adult will pick them up on a motorcycle after school, but they won't know until school's out at 1 o'clock. The last 15 minutes are the hardest. The temptation to just sit in the shade is great.
Okay, let's go.
They know the reason they're making such a great effort. To learn things that will help make their dreams of a good job come true. Juan will soon arrive as well. He gets up his strength for the last stretch.
The most difficult part is the hill we just passed and the one coming up.
To pass the time, Juan practices doing calculations in his head. Math is his favorite subject. After 1.5 hours, Kendys and her friends have finally made it. Just before 8 o'clock, the blue roof of the school appears behind the last hill. This sight alone gives them a shot of energy. The classmates who live a little closer are already there. A total of 15 children between the ages of 6 and 10 go to the school. Education is compulsory in Colombia for 9 years. But only 85% of children actually go to school. Juan finally arrives shortly after 8. Even though he has to take an arduous road, he likes school. For him, it's a welcome change from the hard life on the farm.
Yo les he enseñado, Señor Jesús, te damos gracias por este día de vida que nos das. Te damos gracias por nuestras familias, en el nombre de Jesús. Amén.
Today, the subject of means of communication is part of the curriculum.
Computers.
In addition to general knowledge, the children are taught math, Spanish, art, religion, and sports. The school only gets textbooks through donations. Teacher Yuri buys most of the classroom materials using her meager salary of 350 euros a month. The teacher faces the same challenge every day, teaching 6 different levels, from preschool to 5th grade, all at the same time.
It's very difficult to teach like this. Why? Because I look for a topic that is good for everyone. Then I assign a task that everyone can do, and then another one that is appropriate to the level. This means the tasks have different degrees of difficulty.
2 years ago, most of the children wrote very poorly and came to school irregularly. Yuri is proud that that has changed. Her students really like to go to school now. But there's still one problem. The children arrive exhausted.
They are often tired and have trouble concentrating. But I try to teach things that are fun for the children and where they have to actively participate. I know the circumstances. They don't have it easy. But I always tell them that the effort and learning will pay off in the future.
After 3 hours, the children have a 45-minute break. They can rest and get something to eat.
Sometimes the parents bring something to their kids during the lunch break, but most of them get a break box.
Before I get here, I eat breakfast. And my grandma always gives me something to eat because there's no cafeteria here.
After lunch, there's still time to play. Something Juan doesn't get to do much at home. Here, he can finally be a child. And the fun continues in gym class. The kids love it. They can stop thinking and just goof around. Shortly before 1 o'clock, the end of the lesson approaches, and thus, also the trip back home.
I'm always a little afraid of going back because it's so hot there. And if you go into the water when you're that heated, you can get a shock and drown.
Kendys hopes that her father, Salvador, has time to pick her up with a motorcycle today. It's also not particularly safe, but at least it's better than the wooden bridge. The teacher lets her young charges go, but with mixed feelings. She knows that today she has brought them one step closer to their dreams, but she also knows the trials and tribulations that lie ahead. Kendys and her friend Andrea are lucky. Salvador is already waiting. He can't always pick them up. It depends on whether he or his wife need the motorcycle for something else. It's their only means of transport. The two girls are happy when someone picks them up, although the ride on the motorcycle is also not without its risks.
When it rains, I'd rather walk. When it's so wet, it's easy to slip and get badly hurt.
Yes, the muddy roads are the most difficult. You have to be very careful when driving here. You have to make sure not to slip in the mud. There are also a lot of buffalo here that destroy the ground. It's also very difficult for the kids, and you really have to watch out.
In the morning, it is often too wet and muddy to drive the children safely. By the afternoon, the sun has dried the ground, at least a little bit. Although the people here are very good drivers, there are accidents every day on the bad roads. They slide, fall, and can seriously hurt themselves. The good thing is that it only takes 30 minutes to get back by motorbike. Juan has just completed a quarter of the way. The midday heat is getting to him. 38 degrees Celsius, no wind, and the water supply is limited. Only the trees provide a bit of shade. Juan's grandparents are waiting for him and get worried if he comes home too late. But they also know he takes a break on the way home, and therefore takes a little longer.
sombra bien fresquita.
I like to cry in the tree. It's nice and shady here and cooler, especially in the afternoon, when the sun is even hotter after school. I take a break here. Sometimes I use the leaves as a sunblock. They give me a little shade.
After the short break, Juan goes step by step toward the section of the route he is most afraid of. It's almost 2 in the afternoon. The 10-year-old has been on his feet for 9 hours, and now he has to go back through the water with those dangerous creatures. But there's one thing on his way home he is looking forward to. His favorite place on the river. While Juan still has an hour's walk ahead of him, the others approach their destination after a half-hour ride. Mother Yasiris is relieved to have her youngest back again, and all in one piece.
I'm glad to be home. Now I'll relax and then do my homework.
She enjoys watching TV after school with her 11-year-old sister, Karin. After that, homework calls. Mother Yasiris helps her daughters. She recently returned to school and graduated herself. She has no vocational training. For that, she would have to move to another city and leave her family. But she doesn't want that.
Oh, Mona Lisa es una obra pictórica del pintor renacentista italiano Leonardo da Vinci.
So it's all the more important to her that her two girls are able to make their dreams come true. Meanwhile, Juan has arrived at the river. He still has to cross it, but then he is home. Although he's late, there's one thing he's not going to miss today. Juan loves to swim in a river without dangerous animals.
The water is so nice and cool, and I can relax a little bit. I can swim fast.
One canoe trip later, and he is finally at home, exhausted after a very long day. His grandparents and his work are already waiting for him.
I feel very relieved when he comes home, and nothing has happened. I'm also proud of him when he brings home good marks.
I'm glad to be here and not have to go through the mud and the water anymore. I'm really relieved.
In the late afternoon, Kendys gets together again with her friends. Before they go to bed, the family spend some time together.
I'm very happy when they get home, because every trip to school and back is dangerous.
Even though Kendys is afraid of going to school every day, she knows it's the only chance she has to achieve her career aspirations.
I want to be a great artist. I love to paint. I love painting landscapes.
For this, she goes up against the shaky, rotting wooden bridge every day. She's sure that this is how her dreams will become reality. At 7 o'clock in the evening, Juan is finished with all his tasks. Even though his grandparents are very strict, they do give him support.
I hope that Juan will become an engineer, like my sons. He shouldn't end up as a field worker or a fisherman. I always tell him he has to study.
I want to go to Medellín and study there. I want to be an engineer.
In order to get closer to their wishes and dreams, Juan and the other children from the village, La Veridad La Escuela, have to go to school for the next few years on one of the world's most dangerous ways to school.